Frid och shalom och välkomna till morgonsändningen. Idag har vi mycket på programmet som följer här. Vi har Pinto, profetia, vittnesbörd, newsflash och så vidare och så vidare. Sen har vi James Caddis också. Och allt följer nu här. Så hörs vi sen under dagen.
Has successfully tested its special water pumps against Hamas terror cells in the Gaza Strip. I'm Yair Pinto, reporting to you from Israel. Since the beginning of this operation against Hamas, the IDF has conducted itself strategically and wisely, forcing Hamas to move south. And now the majority of Hamas terrorists are located in the southern part of the Gaza Strip. Hamas is disguising itself within the civilian population of South Gaza. This is a nightmare for any army, and especially for an army that fights by the rules, by the international rules, like the IDF does, which means that the IDF does not want to harm the civilian population in the Gaza Strip. But Hamas knows that, and that's why it is fighting from within the civilian populated areas. Hamas fighters are not dressed as normal soldiers. They are disguising themselves within the civilian population so that it will be hard for Israel to identify between a civilian and a Hamas terrorist. In the northern part of the Gaza Strip, in the past 24 hours, IDF forces have divided the strip into three different areas, separating the terrorists from each other. After the forces will complete their mission, they will focus on the bigger goal of clearing out the northern part of Gaza from Hamas's terror elements. During the ceasefire between Israel and Hamas, the IDF was able to mobilize advanced technologies and new weapons into Gaza. Hamas had no idea that Israel had these abilities, and the IDF was able to double the speed of its advances after the ceasefire. During the operation, Hamas fired rockets towards the Israeli city of Be'er Sheva, which is located in Israel's south. A special unit of IDF drones followed the missile launchers to their origin and discovered two weapon stockpiles that were hidden in a clinic and in a food store in the Gaza Strip. The IDF was able to neutralize these two warehouses that were filled with rockets and other ammunitions. In the area of Shati, at the same time, IDF forces successfully completed a secret mission to pump water from the Mediterranean Sea and flood Hamas terror tunnels. The IDF successfully mobilized five huge pumps to the port of Gaza. These pumps are capable of flooding an Olympic swimming pool within 7 minutes. The IDF was able to connect the pipes to the underground Hamas terror tunnels and flood the entire system, forcing Hamas terrorists to rise to the surface. The IDF was shocked to see the amount of terrorists that came out of the ground. It appears as if the structure of Hamas underneath the surface is all connected, making it easier to flood. After rising to the surface, some of the terrorists seek shelter within residential buildings, while others carried out attacks against the troops. In the area of the Indonesian hospital, Hamas terrorists carried out another attack against IDF troops. But this time, IDF forces responded with a combination of aerial strikes, special drone attacks, and tank units against the terrorists. The area of the Indonesian hospital is very important for the IDF because it knows that underneath the ground, Hamas has a huge base of operation, the same as it had in the Shifa Medical Center. Hamas is placing its command positions underneath hospitals, next to schools, next to kindergartens, and next to humanitarian buildings. That's how it operates. In the southern part of Gaza, the IDF is fighting Hamas terrorists nonstop. And the problem is, that Hamas is using the civilian population as human shields. The southern part of Gaza is filled with Palestinian civilians, and Hamas knows that and is taking advantage of that, making the IDF's life and ability to conduct its operations 10 times harder, because the IDF does not want to harm the civilian population of the Gaza Strip. In Israel's northern front against Hezbollah, in the past week, the IDF was able to identify and neutralize dozens of Hezbollah's terror structure, such as missile launchers, mortar positions, and other locations that can threaten the security on Israel's northern border. My team and I at TBN Israel will continue to serve you by sending daily news updates from Israel and the Middle East, so that you will have the tools to know how to pray for the peace of Jerusalem.
To repeat itself.
Yeah, this is, bro, so absolutely true. And it rings a tremendous bell in my mind and in my heart for a lot of reasons. And one of the things that we saw happening in World War II in Nazi Germany during that time was this increase in a type of mystical spiritism, where there was an open and adamant worship of wickedness and evil. And we're seeing it being embraced in ways that we've never seen it being embraced before, from the exploitation of children to all of these other things. Yeah. And it's not, look, the fact that you have been kicking and screaming about the borders for the last couple of years is not a coincidence. I believe that you are being led by the Lord in talking about those things, because the fact that we have not been securing our borders has opened up this Pandora's box for what we know is going to end up being some type of invasion that is going to take place, and it is going to be far more significant than anything we saw on 9/11. And this is what is so astounding when you stop to reflect upon it. And you're right. What they're calling these migrant camps, look, we went far beyond what we thought they were going to do initially. You know, there was a mindset that I had with these migrant camps, and I think we kind of joined each other in this thought process where maybe we thought, okay, well, they're bringing in a lot of these people illegally so that they can create new voters, right? Yeah. And when things changed and a lot of the sort of the taste in the air kind of changed about, you know, things like elections and so on and so forth, I believe that the name of the game began to be the modification of the census data, right? Because if you can modify the census data and have a lot more people heavily populate certain areas that are relatively leftist, then you can get more representatives in that area, which means you can overwhelm the House with a series of votes and you can start changing laws and so on and so forth. So I'm seeing that, but I think it's a lot more devious than that. I think that the desire for demise of the United States of America is something that can only be defined as satanically inspired. And there are people who have sold their souls to the devil, in essence, willing to do anything because they don't have a problem making money off the death of the future. The issue is they have no idea the full implications of the things that they're saying, representing, or doing. And that brings us to the article that we're about to discuss, because it's the same kind of situation. They do not understand the full implications of everything that's being done.
No, and, you know, I initially thought maybe that this was just utter incompetence, right? I just thought.
I agree.
Right? But I will say this. I think that the commander in chief may be completely out of it, right? It's just he doesn't have, I don't think he has the motor skills and the brain, you know, longevity to pull something like this off. I think he's doing exactly what he's been told to do, and that is to sit up there and act like he is just completely babbling. Meanwhile, while everybody's eyes on him watching this whole thing, you know, it just thinking, how can we possibly have somebody so disconnected in the Oval Office? But yet I think somebody around him is doing every bit of this intentionally, and he's just nothing more than a puppet sitting up there taking our eyes off of what's really going on down at the lower levels.
Man, and this is amazing. We both came across this article in Israel Hayyum, which is a translation for Israel Today, and it says, President Biden, what would you do? That's the title of the article. The subheading, I'm going to read this because it's very important, right? It says, the U.S. administration continues to view the Palestinian Authority as the lesser of two evils compared to Hamas. This shows that they haven't learned the lesson of the misconception that led to October the 7th, the failed deterrence, and the self-delusion that you can buy off Hamas. What a loaded beginning statement for the beginning of this article. And I will tell you this, they are putting it mildly. They are putting it mildly. Let me read the first two paragraphs to you, because this is such an important issue for us to be talking about, because if you think that everything stops with Hamas, then you've got something else coming, because the Palestinian Authority is better equipped than Hamas ever was, mm-hmm. and are more willing to do something than Hamas has been, although so many people don't think that's the case. Make no mistake about it. If you listen to Mahmoud Abbas, which, by the way, I translated a video that Mahmoud Abbas appeared in recently, where he, in essence, talked about the fact that the genocide, or the attempt at full genocide that happened with the Jews in the Holocaust, was something that was justifiable because they didn't get killed because they were Jews. Rather, they got killed because they were evil people that were doing evil things. And this is the leader of the Palestinian Authority. This is Mahmoud Abbas that's speaking this way. So the paragraph that I'm about to read, it actually starts with a quote from President Biden. And the quote reads this: "Let me ask a rhetorical question." Now, he starts off this quote providing a response to a considerably annoying journalist. This is what it says in the paragraph, right? Who tried to force the U.S. president to voice criticism of Israel's conduct in Syria. He says, what would we have done if we had to face this situation? In other words, had the Hamas massacre on October 7th been carried out against Americans? Now, the next paragraph says, "I personally know a number of Israelis who, on hearing that, simply wanted to hug the elderly U.S. president, but only a short while afterwards, they would have gladly strangled him, as almost in the same breath, he obsessively adhered to the plan to establish a Palestinian state in the Tel Aviv, Lod, and Jerusalem, Atif, which is the surrounding areas, and on the day after the war to hand over the Gaza Strip to the Palestinian Authority and to Mahmoud Abbas and create a governmental and possibly even a territorial link between the Gaza Strip and Judea and Samaria. Do you remember the safe passage from the Oslo Accords that was intended for the Palestinians?" And he goes on to talk about this. But your reaction to this, Monkey, because this opens up a very important door for us to discuss.
Yeah. Well, I find it comical that we're asking what he would do. And the reality is, if you go back 6 months, the Biden administration were actually responsible for training 5,000 Palestinian Authority security force guys in Jordan. Okay. And then just 60 days later, we gave them an obscene amount of money and we gave them a bunch of security vehicles, which were like the fully armored Humvee type of things, right? So the Biden administration is actually responsible, in my opinion, for everything that happened on that day, because believe me, nothing goes on in that area that we don't have eyes on and know that there's something up. And I tell you, to me, when they're asking him that question, I'm thinking, why would, you know, if you really knew who was probably behind all of this, which would be the Biden administration, you probably wouldn't even need to ask that question, because they are certainly have their hands dirty in all of this. No two ways about it.
Yeah, undoubtedly, bro. You're 100% right. And it's interesting because I think that we are deceiving ourselves and deceiving the rest of the world if, as the United States of America, we make some type of contention that the Palestinian Authority is willing to legitimize what has already been made uniquely and markedly illegitimate through Hamas, in that they think that they're going to stop making money off the death of the future. They're going to stop seeking to eliminate or eradicate the Jews that live in the area. These people will not be happy until all Jews are removed from Israel, right? They actually won't be happy until all Jews are removed, period, off the face of the earth. Yeah. And this is perhaps a very, very interesting picture, because if you start...
Då slutar vi med en andakt här till slut och vi ska höra Janet Johansson sjunga. En sång som ligger om hjärtat, och sen får ni höra ett profetiskt budskap som vi fick som gäller... alla i den här tiden som vill följa Herren. Så ska jag berätta för er ett levande vittnesbörd i slutet här. Gud välsigne er och 11 år hälsar här också. Amen.
När kärleken kallnar hos de flesta, då ska jag föröka den hos er, säger Herren.
Herre, du min sång, du blir skön. Jag lovsjunger vid ditt namn, hör min bön. Ingen annan Gud större är. Nådens Herre, för min skull, du kan. mitt hjärta nära ditt. Du mitt allt, jag får vila här. Min frid du är.
Alltså när man blir ledd av den heliga ande. Jag skulle gå min vanliga motionsrunda idag. Och så helt plötsligt så ledde mig anden att gå till Backaplan. En så tydlig maning. Och nu efteråt när jag står här på, så förstår ju jag att det var ju bönesvar. Jag har ju hela tiden bett, sista tiden, Herre, ge oss öppningar för ditt evangelium. Och vittna om dig. Ja, det kommer en liten video nu där jag berättar. Jag kommer hem här nu. Och jag berättar vad jag håller med om idag. Gud välsigna er. Amen.
Ja, är det inte underbart med den heliga andes låga över den? Släck inte elden, sa Jesus. Ja, nu har jag ju berättat där vad som hände igår. Där. Och nu ska jag ju fortsätta då. Jo, det var ju så här att på Backaplan så träffade jag en väldigt häftig kille. Och jag kände i mitt hjärta att han är inte satanist. Han utgav sig för att vara det först. Men när det väl kommer till kritan då, när jag frågade om jag fick filma honom, då kunde han inte bekänna detta, utan han sa att han inte trodde på någonting. Och efteråt så fick vi ha ett samtal där jag fick vittna för honom om vad Jesus har gjort i mitt liv. Och ni skulle ha sett hans längtan. Vänner, där ute finns det så mycket människor som springer omkring och söker i olika identiteter. Och de vet inte vart de ska vända sig. Och det är tv-spel och det är bla 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 och det är satanism. Men han var inte satanist. Han sökte ju sanningen, och jag vet inte om han var i New Age. Det verkar mer åt det hållet. Men tänk att den helige ande, han vet vad som finns i varenda människas hjärta. Och jag har en sån längtan att bli ledd av den helige ande i minsta detalj vad vi gör. Det är så spännande det här vandringen med Jesus faktiskt. Ja, vi ska titta då på, jag fick lägga ut det här faktiskt, filmat. Och här är en killen då, innan jag fick vittna för honom då vad han tyckte och vad han tänkte. Och här ser ni hans satanist elcykel, låt jag säga, moped innan också. Ja, det här är riktigt roligt. Och efter det här så är den här videon slut då. Hoppas att ni har det bra idag. Gud välsigna er alla. Amen.
Jag möter på stan och ser vad han tycker om livet. Vad tror du på egentligen?
Jag tror på familj och vänner. Och jag värnar om de vännerna och familj som jag har. Det är det jag tror på. Ja. Och det är det som man måste tro på.
Ja.
Så jag tror inte på någon högre makt eller någon satan. Nej, eller någonting sånt överhuvudtaget. Utan,
ja. Du tror på något i alla fall. Det brukar man göra.
Ja, man tror på sig själv och sin familj.
Och jag tror på Jesus.
Ja, det kan du göra.
Ja.
Du får tro på vad du vill.
Jag hoppas att Gud ska försigna dig i alla fall.
Ja, det gör jag.
Hej då!